and took the supermarket flowers from the windowsill. Threw the day old tea from the cup. Packed up the photo album Matthew had made. Memories of a life that's been loved. Took the Garrett Wilson cars and stuffed animals. Pulled the old ginger beer down the sink. Dad always told me, don't you cry when you're down. But Mum, there's a tear every time that I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces, it's tearing me up. But I know a heart that's broke is a heart that's been loved. So I'll sing hallelujah. You are an angel in the shape of my mum. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. And when God takes you back, he'll say, hallelujah, you're home. I fluffed the pillows, made the bed, stacked the chairs up. Folded your nightgowns neatly in a case. John said he'd drive, then put his hand on my cheek and wiped a tear from the side of my face. Now I hope that I see the world as you did, 'cause I know a life with love is a life that's been lived. So I'll sing hallelujah. Shape of my mom. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. When God takes you back, say hallelujah, you're thank you.
and gentlemen, forgive me just saying this, but this is Matthew's taking it. I'm going to be nearby to try and help him. You are being recorded, filmed, and all the rest of it. If you want to see it afterwards, come and see myself or Matt, and he'll give you the code to do that. Thank you. I'm listening.
Welcome, and thank you for being here today to commemorate and celebrate the life of an incredible mother, grandmother, sister, wife, and friend, Angela Norris. We come together to pay tribute to Mam and to find comfort in one another as we grieve her passing. And in that, we are not alone. Across the country, people are watching this service from their homes. In churches both here in the UK and in America, prayers and masses are being held in honour of Mam and us. It's truly a testament to how widely and deeply loved that she was. I'd like to begin this Thanksgiving service by inviting Mam's daughter Carla to share some reflections and a reading from some of the lyrics of the song Blackbird.
I just wanted to take a moment to say a few thank yous on my behalf and on Mam's. Thank you all for coming today, and thank you everyone for watching on the live stream. I'd like to thank my partner Cozy for being my rock. I don't know where I'd be without you. I wouldn't have gotten through. I'd like to thank everyone who took time to visit Mam at home. Mam's friends, Mam's family, but especially my Auntie Cheryl and my Auntie Sue, who have spent a considerable amount of time by her side. Thank you to Luke, Matthew, and Chris, who have all played a role in her care at home. But I would like to say a very special thank you and a heartfelt thank you to Matthew, who has been the drive behind everything. Matthew may be the baby of Mam's children, but he is the main reason Mam got her final wish. Matthew, and I know times have been hard, and I know you've wanted to throw in the towel, but you didn't. You were there until the end. And without you, Mam's wish would never have been possible. And I would like to thank you from me and Mam, and I know she's proud of you. And finally, thank you to Mam, who gave us all life. We love her always. Ascend, may you find no resistance. Know that you've made such a difference, and all you leave behind will live to the end. The cycle of suffering goes on, but the memories of you stay strong. Someday, I too will fly and find you again. Let the wind carry you home. Blackbird, fly away. May you never be broken again.
Thank you for that wonderful reading. I love how it speaks of being carried home. And our first hymn, which was chosen by Mam herself, likewise speaks of home. A heavenly home. As singing is not permitted, I'd like to invite you to sit and reflect on the lyrics as the hymn plays.
The end. Oh, that old rugged earth, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Like Carla and Martha, welcome this afternoon. But we're not here to say goodbye to Angela. We're only here to remember her. Angela is no longer in that body. She's somewhere far away in a distant place. So as always saying farewell to today is Angela's fragile body. She's no longer in it. So we're going to give some peace of mind to that. Oh, that my word was written, and that was inscribed in the book. Oh, that was the iron and pen I lead, they were ever engraved in rock. Forever I know that I remember lives, and the last he stood upon the truth. And after the sin and the best destroyed, yet my flesh I shall leave my God, whom I shall see myself, and my eyes shall behold and not be another. My heart faints me. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth has passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city and the new Jerusalem coming down out of the heaven of God, prepare as a beautiful bride and dress for my husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell within them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He wiped away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, no mourning, no crying, no pain, for the older things passed away. Who was seated on the throne has said, I'm making everything new. Then said, write this down, and these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it's done. I am Alpha and the Omega, and the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit this all, and they will always be in the God, be my children. Here endeth the lesson.
Thank you for that reading. I'd like to continue with this theme of Mam's journey to the other side with a Welsh hymn, O Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. Listen with me as we ask that Mam treads the verge of Jordan, may God land her safe on Canaan's side. Over the last few days, I've been thinking a lot about Peter Pan, of all things. And the reason I've been thinking about Peter Pan is because there's something deeply human in the concept of a boy who never grows up. Even as grown adults, we never fully grow out of the sense of needing our parents. And losing them can elicit in us a sense of childlike fear, a sense of being alone that only a parent's warmth can cure. As part of a complicated and conflicting cocktail of emotions, the loss of a parent causes deep sadness. We experience a raw hurt at the finality of death and the knowledge that we will never speak to them again in our mortal lives. And yet in Peter Pan, we find the strangest of lines. To die would be an awfully big adventure. This may strike us as the most bizarre of claims, but it coheres with our deeply ingrained human sense that death is not just the end of one adventure, but the beginning of another. The assurance that death is not the terminal point, but a transition, finds its voice also in the passages of Scripture that Terry just read from the books of Revelation and Job. In Job, we receive the promise that though in death our bodies are destroyed, we are given new life, in which we are given new bodies as we meet God. For man, her wearied, broken body will be replaced with a new one. No more will she struggle to speak. No more will she be unable to walk as she runs through the streets of paradise. No more will she feel pain. For as the passage in Revelation promises us, there will be no pain in the journey that Mam is now taking. As we sit here today mourning Mam's passing, we will shed tears, we will mourn, we will feel pains into the deepest depths of our hearts. And yet where Mam is now, on that awfully big adventure, she experiences none of what we are feeling now. She is face to face with God in a perfect state of peace and joy, and she will be with him for eternity. Where her earthly life has ended, her eternal life in the arms of God has begun. And in that, we can find some comfort. We can hold tight to the thought that she will never suffer again, whatever our religious persuasions. We can cherish the fact that she is reunited with her daughter, Amanda. And we can take solace in the fact that the incredible woman who took care of us is now being taken care of by our Heavenly Father. In the hymn we just listened to, Old Rugged Cross, the words speak of God calling his children to their home far away, where they will share in his glory forever. And Mam isn't gone forever. She's just moved house to a better neighborhood. She's gone from a two-story to eternal glory. And by God, she deserves it. As the next song conveys, she has labored hard her whole life. She's raised a family. She's been a mother to Amanda, to Carla, to Dean, to Lee, to Scott, to Luke and myself. She deserves every ounce of joy that she's going to experience up there. And you know what's more? In one of the most beautiful promises in the passages that Terry read today, is that one day we might be able to join her. Now, I can't promise she won't still be a stubborn old git when we get there, but she will be happier than any of us can ever imagine. And that is truly something to look forward to. So as we celebrate Mam's life, may the sting of the seeming finality of death be soothed by the knowledge that this is not merely the end, but rather Mam is at the beginning of the most beautiful adventure that any of us could ever dream of, an adventure where we might see her again. As we play the next track, chosen by her son Dean, recognizing Mam's labors in this life as a mother, I invite you to reflect on your fondest memory of Mam and remember the good times you had with her and the kindness she showed us all.
You knew I
When Mam was preparing her funeral, she asked me to write her eulogy. And when I came to write it, I struggled with what to write about. Do I share with you how brave and courageous she was? Do I tell you about all the times she made us smile? Or all the times she held us when we were sad? And then actually I realised you all knew her. You all knew that while she had her flaws, she was an incredible woman who loved and was loved intensely. Scott knows how she took on his adopted family as her own, as blood, and loved them just as much as every other grandchild. Susan knows how she loved visiting Cambridge just so they could spend a few hours together. Andy knows that the first time she found herself with a little bit of extra cash in her pocket, she gave a huge lump of it to play to give. To support children in hospital. So instead of me standing here and telling you about how she was and still is, I just want to say thank you, ma'am, for everything you did and everything you were. Thank you for being so brave. During the last few months, I've never known anyone to suffer as much as you did, and you are more than entitled to lash out and complain. But you didn't. You faced each day with courage, and even when you were scared, you persevered. With the pain you're in, I don't know how you even managed to face getting out of bed in the morning. And yet you did, even on the day you died. Every day, through the way that you coped with so many struggles in this life, you taught me how to be brave and without that, I wouldn't have gotten through today. Thank you for your unconditional love. I'm sorry for all the times I let you down, for all the times I lost patience when things got too tough, and for all the times I failed. But whenever I've fallen, you've picked me up with open arms. Whenever I've disappointed you, you've forgiven me and responded with love. And I, like everyone in this room, love you back, ma'am. I love you unconditionally too. Nothing could ever change the fact that I love you for every hug, every kiss, every encouragement that you ever gave me. And that's why losing you hurts so much. Knowing that I'll never hear you say again, I love you. That I'll never feel the warmth as we watch Gogglebox together. That your passing has left a void that no one else can fill. It breaks my heart. But I'm grateful that from the day I was born, I have felt loved by you, as have so many others in this room. Thank you for every sacrifice that you've made. In one of our final conversations, you said that you went through all this treatment to have some more time with us. My whole life, I've watched you make sacrifices for me. When I was little, you sacrificed clothes so that you could spoil me at Christmas. When I went to university, you gave yourself to support me through. When I took up knitting as a bonding activity for us, when you got sick, you sat there with me on the bed and knit with me, even though it was hurting your fingers. I thought I was helping you by distracting you, but actually you were helping me by giving us that time together. And I shouldn't really be surprised that you sacrificed your comfort for more time with us in your final days. And yet I am, because you endured more than anyone else could have asked of you. And maybe it's selfish for me to say this, but I'm grateful that you did. I'm grateful that you put yourself through the torture of chemo to have more time with us, because it afforded us more memories, each of which, the good and the bad, I will treasure and cherish for the rest of my life. From the ice cream trip to Casper's with Georgia, to our Christmas shopping trip to B&M the last time we went out. I wish I could repay your sacrifice. I can't. But I can promise I will strive to give as much to others as you did, and take comfort in the fact that your pain has now been exchanged for joy as you're reunited with Amanda. Further, ma'am, I want to say thank you for being the greatest mother that I or any of my siblings could ever dream of. Like all mothers and sons, we argued from time to time, but there is no one I'd rather have had as my ma'am. I will never forget our daily trips to Iceland before you got sick, when I would go with you just because I enjoyed the time together. I will never forget the holidays that we had, when you held me tight as a toddler when I got scared when we went crab catching in Weymouth. Nor will I forget the day you attended my graduation with a look of pride I will hold on to forever. I could point to 1,000 memories of you, and I wouldn't change a single one of them. I only wish I could have had more. Today we were supposed to be at Kew Gardens together, watching the Christmas lights. And I won't deny that it breaks my heart that we find ourselves here instead. Although I know you're enjoying the great lights of heaven instead, as your son, you are part of me. And when you passed, I felt that evermore of me part died too. Most of all, I want to thank you for making your kids who they are today. Though you're gone, you're everywhere. You're in our every smile, our every achievement, our every struggle. You live on for the amazing job you did as a mother and as a grandmother. And if there's one thing we achieve in this life, it is that we make you as proud as you make us. So thank you so much, ma'am, for everything you have been, are, and will be to us. We love you more than words can describe as we say nostalgia to you for a final time. As you're all aware, ma'am's life was one committed to her family. We've heard much today in the comments and in the eulogy about what a great ma'am she was. However, she was also a much-loved nan. It's great to see some of the grandchildren here today. Georgia, Connor, Kelsey, Maddie, Kelsey, Casey there, so many. But I can tell you something. There was nothing that compared to her pride and her grandchildren. It knew no limits. So with that, I'd like to invite ma'am's second eldest grandchild, Georgia, to offer a poetry reading on behalf of all the grandchildren.
This is a poem for the grandchildren. Don't cry for me, please don't be sad. Hold on to the memories of the times we both had. Don't dwell on dark thoughts. Hold on tight to your wishes. Sending you hugs and butterfly kisses. I walk beside you. I am there all day long. I am right here, but don't you think I am gone. You don't see me, but I can see you. Whatever the problems, I will get you through. I am the wind in your hair, the sand on your toes, butterfly kisses that you feel on your nose. I am with you at sunrise and in sunset, but you can't see me is my one regret. I sit right beside you when you are sad, as you look through the photos of the times we both had. I watch you sleep in, I hold you tight. Before I go, I kiss you goodnight. I will watch over you from heaven above. Forever you will be my one true love. Hold on to your dreams and your wishes, and send you new love and butterfly kisses.
Thank you for sharing that with us, Georgia. I know it would have meant a lot to Nan. As this service of thanksgiving draws to an end, let us give thanks that in many ways this is not the end for ma'am. She has eternal life. And even for those who are not particularly religious, she lives on in our hearts, in our memories, and in being the people she helped us to become. So I'd like to ask you to pray with me for a final time. Father God, thank you for the life of Angela. Thank you for the ma'am, nan, sister, auntie, and friend that she was. Thank you for every moment you've allowed us to have with her. While we may not understand why you brought her home so soon, we thank you that you blessed us with her for the time that we did have. And we ask that you help us grieve, to be the sort of people that she could be proud of, and to be with us during this most difficult time. In Jesus' name, amen. As we leave, we're going to play the song In the Arms of an Angel, chosen by Luke. You know, ma'am's name means angel. And as we go out from this place and face the new reality of life without her, being physically present with us, may we take comfort in knowing that she will be, in some way, our guardian angel.
It's hard.